with several of my shows, I am really concerned about the future of small business and thought that this could be a show where some experts, and in particular small business owners on the front lines, are able to share what they're doing during this trying time in order to stay alive and stay afloat during a pandemic, something none of us ever expected. And so this gentleman that I'm bringing on next is not only a friend, but has also been a mentor, but also a wealth of information about what to do in times like this. As a matter of fact, the first webinar that I participated in, this young man conducted about the loan and the grant process and the differences and how you can apply and who is eligible, all started with this gentleman who shared information with me. And now I'm asking him to join us to share information with you. His name is Orlando. Good morning, Orlando Espinosa.
Good morning. How are you doing today?
Very good. Very good. Thank you for agreeing to do this. The minute I called him, he was like, "I'm in. I'll do it."
Yeah, what do you want? What do you need?
Exactly.
I'm bored. I need something to do.
Everybody needs something to do. So this will do it. This is my best time. Yesterday when I was talking to Celia, she was like, "Thank you for giving me a reason to put on makeup." Exactly.
Thank you for giving me a reason to put on this jacket.
I do what I can do. First, let's start with who you are and what you do.
Okay, Orlando Espinosa, co-founder of Emineo Media. We design, develop, and implement outreach curriculum to help small businesses, to help municipalities, government agencies, and organizations market their brand.
So did you start? And, you know, as I mentioned, you're now into sort of this small business development training space. And that's how I met you through SBA. But did you start there? Was that what Emineo Marketing initially was?
No. When we actually started, I was in the student lending industry, and my business partner and I, we were talking and we got along extremely well. And we launched in 2009, and we were talking about marketing. So our focus was, hey, we've marketed brands for other major Fortune 500 companies. And we talked a lot about those opportunities. And we said, hey, maybe we can help the small businesses to come in and actually start marketing what they do. And things shifted in 2012. Mm-hmm. I mean, 2012 was probably the worst year of my life, because really? Everything that I touch turns to gold. And I remember waking up in the morning from bed, going to the actual sofa and just waiting and saying, nothing's happening. Mm-hmm. And one day I said, I'm done. This is not who I am. This is not define me. And I started doing a training. I actually did training for American Airlines. I did training for their dangerous goods. And I realized how it's easy for me to actually retain information and then simplify it for other people. And then from there, we just evolved into, I actually started working with SCORE, got a contract with SCORE, and started developing their curriculum, their programs. And I think that's where we initially met. Mm-hmm. But I sat back and realized, what do small businesses do? Overthink. What do small mm-hmm. businesses need? Simplification. So my thing is more coming in and just simplifying the process so that small businesses don't overthink. But guess what? That's the same thing in life. Because mm-hmm. when I worked with middle, high school, and college students, they used to overthink everything. So I think right now for me, it was coming in and saying, there's a need to come in and educate the small business community, because I've been to workshops, I've been to seminar, and mm-hmm. you're being hit left and right. Sell. Oh, I can give you that information, but you have to buy my products. I can give you that, but you have to sign up for another workshop that I have that's going to be more costly, because right now I'm just giving you a teaser. So mm-hmm. I sat back and said, listen, information is free.
Right.
Information is free. But if you come in and you compile it and you put it together and deliver it in an actual concise manner, mm-hmm. it just makes it easier, because my overall goal is, how do you empower people to reach their full potential, whether it's in business or in life?
Well, I have to agree with that 100%, because as I mentioned, the webinar, going through this process with the epidemic and the loans and the grants and resources, there are all these things coming at you. Congress approved this $2.2 trillion package, but nobody understood it. And Orlando brought together a group of us on a webinar or a Zoom call conference call with an attorney who actually read the entire policy. So he broke it down to us in essentially 12 PowerPoint pages. It was awesome. So I have to thank you definitely for that. But do you have people calling you regularly asking you still about, you know, how is this process working and what are you advising small businesses doing this process in terms of looking at those resources and avenues?
All the time. I'm being bombarded with information because I think that people also in this time, they want someone to come in and help them. Mm-hmm. And I think that one of the issues that we have is that people put a price tag on everything. Oh, mm-hmm. I can help you, but for 10% of XYZ, I can do this. And at the end of the day, I tell people a lot of people are accumulating wealth and they're not going to be able to take it with them. Mm-hmm. So why don't you do the right thing and just help? So yeah, so the person that actually was sharing that was Senen mm-hmm. Garcia, and Senen read that and see Senen understands. So I tell people stay in your lane. What mm-hmm. is good for you? And Senen read it. We've done a lot of seminars, webinars since then. But one thing that I always tell people, create a game plan because we're being bombarded. Oh well, you have to apply for the mm-hmm. the idle loan. The EIDL loan. Oh, but you have to apply for the PPP. Oh, you have to go ahead and go to mm-hmm. The Florida Bridge loan. And one of the things that I tell a lot of the business owners, create a game plan, because a lot of businesses, unfortunately, COVID-19 has affected a lot of people, but it's affected more businesses. And it's sad to say, but a lot of businesses are not going to survive. Right. And one of the reasons being is because they don't listen. They're not listening to what things you're doing. You need to come in and create a game plan. So when people tell me, oh, I'm going to apply for everything, you're still applying for a loan. You're applying for a loan. An SBA loan that 3.75 interest rate for small businesses, 2.75 interest rate for nonprofits, private nonprofits. But then you got the PPP. And that is for businesses to actually help with payroll. So I keep saying to businesses, if you're going to take out the PPP, have a game plan. Yes, you want to help the small business, not small business, your employees. But what are you going to do? Pay them to stay at home? If you do, that's your choice. But how are you going to start creating something different to pivot your business?
Right, right.
I think that that's right now, when you look at businesses, people are not coming in and doing something different. I mean, I applaud you for coming in and taking charge and doing something like this, but people are scared of being in front of the camera. People are scared of inquiring, asking questions. But I sit back and realize that a lot of businesses, if they would have come in and done the right thing, because it goes back to the right thing. Mm-hmm. Are you paying yourself? So a lot of people that never pay themselves, paid themselves. Now they want to apply for the triple P, but they said, but I never paid myself. So I think that what the government is doing right now is trying to help as many businesses, because mm-hmm. they've also opened it up to 1099 consultants, mm-hmm. To sole proprietor, yes. to yes. be able to apply. But my thing is, if you are okay and you say, I really don't need the money because I am an essential business, mm-hmm. then let someone that's not an essential business go after some of the funding.
Right.
Now, the only thing is that have a game plan and say, well, I'm not going to do the triple P because it really doesn't make sense, because you're still borrowing money. And once you borrow, you're going to have to fill out an application and submit all of the documents in order to have that mm-hmm. loan forgiven. So, and even if that loan is at 1%, 2 years, a lot of people are going to get into trouble because right. they're not processing it.
And right. you tapped on so many pieces that I want to hop on right there, but I got to keep them all in my head. But first, I will start with that. One of our first guests, Nicole Gates, talked about, in many of the things that we are learning as business owners now, is the need to be organized and keep your documents in order. I think a lot of people are finding now this is hindering them. As you mentioned, I had not been paying myself, so I have no history of payment. All of these types of things that are coming into play, are you finding that is the case for most small businesses you're dealing with? Or you tend to be dealing with businesses that are a little more savvy, a little bit on the ball when it comes to being on top of their documents? Because I spoke to Celia Nelson yesterday, who was a nonprofit. They have to be on top of their documents. So that's one of the things that we're learning as for-profits right now. What are you finding in your communication?
Well, I think that one of the things is making sure, okay, we all have a hustle. And you and I have talked about this before. People know how to make money. People have a side hustle. You know what? When we lived off of 79th Street, my parents and I, and there's certain conversations that we would have in the neighborhood. And I remember the woman that would sell the plates of food. And I remember someone would actually sell the frozen cups. And I remember someone else that was taking care of kids, you know, and someone else's children. So everybody had a side hustle. The thing is that you have to change the mindset from that side hustle to the reality of running an actual business, because there's people that are talented at doing things. So if you want to come in and grow, and it's all about growth, because I know people that are satisfied being a one person show and they're making money and they're happy and that's okay. Then I know other people that want to scale and grow your business, but it goes back to, as a business owner, do the right thing for the right reason. Right. Because if you are creating jobs, you have to come in and make sure you're doing the right thing to help not only your employees, customers, and so forth. So I think that that's just a mind shift, because we are so used to coming in and making money and saying, okay, so I'm paying my bills, I'm paying this, I'm paying that. But if you really want to scale, then you have to formulate a plan and say, I am an actual business. I am an entity that is registered with the state, the county, the city, whatever. And people don't want to pay into that because they say, oh no, I need to have more money in my pocket.
But so, I think on the back end of that, I noticed one of the things I just shared with you. I was in a workshop once where, you know, we've had a couple of years of people really wanting to invest in small business, and that's wonderful. But I don't think we've really vetted the difference between the hustle game and the small business game. If you are going to invest these resources into a small business, you've got to make sure that they are prepared and have the tools and have a good shot at being successful, versus sort of just investing in the hustle game. So do you think that this pandemic is now forcing everyone to sort of look at that paradigm a little differently as we move forward?
Well, I hope so. I hope so, because listen, we are actually doing things that we've never done before. This to me is nothing new, because I work from home and I've actually been doing a lot of webinars, even though I still do a lot of out in the community. I mean, I'm working with Venture Cafe, their Overtown Connect program, and amazing students. And amazing students that know, and they just need to be given a fair chance and opportunity with a wealth of information. And my thing is that one of the key things for them was, you know, when we had class last night, was what's your takeaway? And I think it's the follow-up, because we have people that come in and we give you this, but then we really don't teach you how to do and what to do next. And I mean, even teaching the SBA Emerging Leaders Program, I have got a wealth of friends in that these are people, businesses that came in, and when they applied, we started building rapport, building relationships. But one of the things that I'm a stickler with is saying you need not relationships, you need the right relationships, the right connections. So you need people like Senan, who's an attorney. You need Raju with the FPDC, that he's a guru when it comes to finance. You need, you know, Karen Vieira, that, you know, phenomenal writer, you know, and I can go on and on about everybody that we work with, but a lot of the relationships, even having a relationship with the SBA and seeing everything that they've done in order to come in. Listen, they are on overtime doing webinars and hours in the morning and the evening and trying to get the information out there. And I think that that's one of the things. Then you look at the SBDC, that they're out there also, you know, working and helping with the Florida Bridge Loan. And it's sad when a lot of businesses take on the attitude of, me, I can do it all because I'm self-sufficient. And guess what?
No, that's not true.
It's not true. And if you look at, I think that we work better with our imperfections. And I laugh because I was looking at the image that you shared. And that's one of my favorite images with marketing, because my glasses are a little tilted. But I did it on purpose, because I think that as business owners, we don't have all the answers. I don't have all the answers, but I'm willing to ask and inquire, but keeping documentations, talking to the right people, building relationship, building rapport, that is what makes or breaks a business. And during this pandemic, a lot of people have shifted their mindset to where this is the most common thing that people are doing. They've got a remote control right now. This is not a remote, it's a phone, but you know what? But shifting and changing. Oh, I'm binge watching. And I'm looking at their habits. You have to change your habits.
Right.
And you have to change your mindset if you really want to get past this situation that we're in, because in essence, we are also being controlled.
Right.
You know, you can't do this, you can't do that. And I'm the type of person, when you tell me I can't do something,
I'm gonna do whatever you tell me I can't do.
you tell me, oh no, you can't go into overtime because you don't fit the right, you know, a description.
I'm like, whatever.
Exactly. And I'm like, people understand and know authenticity.
Right. I agree.
And when you're authentic and you want to help people, I've always said this. I've always wanted to learn from the people that are smarter than I am. Mm-hmm. I've always wanted to learn from the people that are more competent. And I'm not looking at race, color, gender. I'm just looking at what they're saying, what they're teaching. And I have been able to scale and grow my business because I have an eclectic group of not only friends, but people that I work with and people that we genuinely trust one another. And mm-hmm. I believe that that's where business owners, we need to start learning how to trust one another.
I agree. You tapped on that a little bit earlier where you talked about, you know, in the nonprofit space, there's a lot of collaboration, partnership, because you sort of have to be. Unfortunately, in for-profit business, there's a lot of competition. You're always sort of in this competitive space. So how do you nurture healthy relationships, especially when you're dealing with people in the same industry? And another question I thought about as you were talking is the time now, is it a good time right now to start a business?
Listen, I think that now is a phenomenal time to start a business because people have time.
What else you got to do? Start a business.
Time, and it's a perfect time to pivot your business.
Right, absolutely.
Start shifting and changing. And I think that right now it's just, listen, three things that I stand by: my integrity, my authenticity, and the other thing is my honesty. One thing is that I'm going to be candid with you. What you see is what you get. But my business, three and a half weeks ago, I said, how can I help people? And how can I come in and do more of a grassroots, because marketing, because you and I, we've done this.
We've talked about this before.
So having the opportunity to come in, and we did a webinar with the SBA Emerging Leaders Program. And we were talking about the CARES Act. We were talking about everything that highlighted was in it. And we had someone from the SBA, you know, Raju from the SBDC present. But we started talking. And when we started sharing, you know, Jonelle specifically was on that webinar for the emerging leaders. And when we started talking and sharing, it was just, okay, let me invite other people and let me invite. Mm-hmm. And that opened up the door for us to start creating and doing webinars for other entities and other locations. Mm-hmm. So the North Miami CRA, Rasha, executive director, she reached out to me and she says, I want to organize something like this for my small business community, and being able to do that. And I've worked with the city of North Miami before on a workforce program. But when you start calculating and saying, okay, so then from there, we went through there. Then we went with the town of Miami Lakes. We went with the city of Doral. Mm-hmm. We went with the city of Homestead CRA. We did something with the city of Oakland Park. Mm-hmm. So CRA. And I think that that's one of the things right now that I was able to do a lot of those things because of the connections.
Right.
Because people trust me. And because if I come up and I say, hey, let's come in and let's do this, because listen, I can create all day and I can come in and do new things. But I think that it's based on trust, mm-hmm. and it's based on relationships, because number one, you don't want to let people down, but you especially don't want to let your family and friends down.
Right.
I believe that those relationships, to say, okay, for you, you know what? I've been hearing your talking business series, and one of the most common thread is we're friends. You know, this is my friend. This is my good friend. And looking at, you know, Salia, and looking at Nicole. Right. You know, and looking at Nicole, and what Nicole has done with the little greenhouse.
Yeah.
Phenomenal. And I've been there, and it's coming in and supporting the small businesses, mm-hmm. and having conversations and being able to just share, because this here is extremely powerful. Mm-hmm. And you have to use it to the benefit of creating something. So I do believe that this is a great time to create something if you're idle, if you're not doing anything. And I believe that this is a great time also to pivot and to have conversations with other people. Listen, we have technology. You don't have to leave out of your house.
Right. You can talk to anybody at this point.
Exactly. The one thing that you have to stop doing is stop opening the refrigerator door.
That's a whole nother talk show, Orlando Espinosa.
It's like you have to say, no. It's like you have to say, hold up, wait a minute.
You know, like I told everybody, my claim to fame or what I'm excited about is I haven't gained any weight. I haven't lost any, but I haven't gained any. So I'm doing pretty good.
And I think that's congratulations to you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. So another workshop that I've done with Orlando, I mean, actually is with one of our community partners here in Overtown, Douglene Jackson. She did a webinar on your vision board for your business. I believe it was last Friday. It was very good. Initially, I wasn't going to go because I actually am a person that does a vision board once a year. But I decided to do it because I wanted to just kind of revisit what I put on the board, especially considering some things that are happening today. What was ironic is on my board, the word, I literally have the word pivot on. So I was sort of in pivot plan, growth plan mode anyway. But this gave me a chance to sort of validate I was thinking in the right direction. Maybe it's time for me to try and do some different things, figure out how to make those things work for my business. So it was a really good exercise. And I do encourage all small business owners, if you're able to do something like that, really, 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 it's a really good idea right now. So as you talk about pivot plans, here's my next question. You work very closely with a lot of local government agencies. I've heard you mention like community redevelopment agencies, some local communities. What do you think the responsibility of local government is in order to help get these businesses back on track after all of this? The federal government has made an investment. They're talking about making another. Now, how can local government now continue that process once we're back in line?
Okay. One thing is that I will pin this first on the small businesses.
Okay.
And ask them, what is your responsibility to get your business back online, because it's your business. And then once you have that answer, then you come in and say, what can I get from the local government in order to assist and help me? Okay. Is it more webinars? Is it more information? Because at the end of the day, it's our business. And if my business succeeds or fail, it's because of me. It's not because of what I didn't get from another entity and so forth. But I do believe that now, once we have that responsibility, then we have to go out and tell some of the local government what we need. Mm-hmm. What is going to help us? Are we going to need more funding? Are we going to need grants? Are we going to need workshops? Are we going to do webinars? Because the thing is that local government is great, but they're not business owners.
Right. Absolutely. Absolutely. So they don't know what we need.
Mm-hmm. Federal government, they're not business owners. Mm-hmm. We're business owners. We're the ones that are saturating the economy. We're the ones, you know, according to the SBA, that have created over 90 million jobs, you know, and there's over 30, you know, million small businesses. And I think those stats are right. But we're the ones that are the creative beings. We're the ones that are smart enough. So I would encourage the local government agencies to create a task force of small businesses so that we
can help them.
What businesses are going through and what businesses need, because they don't understand what it is to come in and have to save money because you're waiting for that contract that never comes.
I agree.
Then you're sitting back and you're waiting because they're getting their weekly paycheck or monthly or whatever it is that they get paid. And I commend them for doing that. But I still think that we have conversations. And what happened with a lot of these grassroots webinars we started doing was that we were being bombarded with everybody's doing a COVID-19, everybody.
Right, absolutely.
And everybody
absolutely.
And their mother was doing one, but it's like people that are talking were not business owners.
Right.
People that were sharing information, you do not identify with what I go through because we are different species. Yep. So that's how we decided to come in and do these grassroots webinars to highlight it and talk about it. And then through relationships, it's highlighting, listen, we're going to have a conversation with Venture Cafe at 4 o'clock. We're doing something in regards to, you know, the COVID, you know, 19. And the thing that I enjoy is going back to the relationships. You know, I'm working with Raju once again with Althea from the SBA, with Senin, you know, from SBA Law Group. But I say that because these are conversations that we've had as business owners to come in and put our ideas together to say, how can we come in? So we actually dissected what was needed. So I encourage any government agency, local, to reach out to the small business community. And don't just reach out to the people that you know, reach out to other people that you don't know and get to know, because I believe that right now, I've got so many business owners that are reaching out to me that they're struggling, but I have business owners that are shifting and changing. You know, Carolina Montoya with a unique cake design. I had a conversation with her 2 weeks ago. I go, Carolina, I've got an idea for you. Why don't you come in and create a virtual baking class because you have your cake company. And you do that with parents, because parents are with their kids and they're out, you know what, fish out of water because they're spending so much time. So why don't you come in and teach them how to bake? You know what? I think what I said was to bake muffins and cupcakes. But then she loved the idea, but she took it one step further. And what did she do? She actually came in and created a do-it-yourself Easter kit where it had cookies. Then the box had the cookies, it had the icing, it had the sprinkles, it had everything. And then she did a Zoom call on, and it was like in 3 days, I'm looking at her post and it's like sold out. That's how you come in and use your mind to start creating. I say that because as business owners, we view things differently. So because we view things differently, the government needs to view things the way that we view it.
We view things exactly
the way that our brain thinks and how we operate, because we're the ones creating the jobs. You don't have major corporations right now creating jobs. And listen, I love colleges and I love universities, but you know, we tend to come in and empower them a lot, but a lot of what they're teaching is theory, you know, and we're teaching
application.
Yeah, exactly. Reality. And I love that contrast. Yes. Teach the theory. But if you don't have, you know, what skin in the game, because you and I have talked about this, that our income sometimes is inconsistent. Contracts, you know, people want in and want a proposal and you create a proposal. And then you find out, you know, 2 days later that they gave it to a friend so that the friend can actually do that and create it.
Right.
So,
absolutely.
You know, all of that.
Absolutely. Everybody dealt with that.
Exactly. So those are conversations that we need to have. And I hope that this opens up the doors for more conversations.
And another idea you talked about, I learned recently that I thought was very innovative, is some restaurant owners are now selling directly to grocery stores. I was like, who would have thought of that? Except, but for you're trying to stay alive and stay afloat and keep your employees employed. So, you know, you talk about really being able to pivot. This is a perfect time for people to look really deeply at some opportunities and some thoughts and some things they hadn't thought of before. Have you yourself applied for any of those loans?
Nope.
And how have you found the process? Oh, you have not. You haven't wanted to.
I didn't want to because I sat back and I know the process. I know that the SBA simplified the EIDL process. It's simplified. The PPP, that's in the hands of the banks. And that's in the hands of the banks. And the banks are actually coming in and they're telling you what they need. Some banks are requiring other things. The application is the same, but they have other stipulations that they're asking for. I know people that have received money already from both ends. But I know that right now, listen, they're overwhelmed.
Yeah, and absolutely.
They're overwhelmed with everything. I know that the SBDC was helping businesses with the Florida Bridge loan. So I made a conscientious decision years ago. In 2012, as I shared earlier, things were not the best for me, but I made a conscientious decision that I was never going to be in that predicament again. So right. I'm a saver. I save money and I like to save money, and I'm comfortable to where I can say, what's the most important thing for me? Paying my mortgage. So I went in and I paid That I've got a 2009 Honda Civic that I bought from my niece. And I tell people, I'm not going to impress anybody with the purpose of what? You know, I always tell people, when business owners, when you lead with your passion and not your title.
Right.
Because we want to come in and impress people and say, well, I'm driving, you know what, the latest XYZ.
Right, absolutely.
And I've got this and I've got. And right now, this is a time for businesses to start trimming the fat.
Right.
And coming and changing. I don't have cable. I got rid of cable. I have internet. And we know that right now, you know, doing all of these Zoom calls and so forth is like, this is customary.
Right. Hello? Did I lose you?
No, I did it on purpose.
Did I lose you? Are you stuck? Are you stuck?
No, but, and that's customary for us, but we become creative.
Right.
And I think that that's the thing that I decided that I'm not going to apply. Number one, I don't need it. Number two, it would be great to have extra, you know what, cash flow. Mm-hmm. But I sat back and I realized that there's other businesses that probably would need it more than I do. And I sat back, but I know that the process, I know a lot of businesses that have actually created. I think the worst part of all of this is the waiting. The right. waiting to go back if you were approved. The waiting to hear back if someone got the application. I know that that the SBA, you know what, they have a hotline right now for the disaster loan. And you know what, I know that they're looking to hire more people
right.
to come in and manage that. Listen, we are in a situation right now that we've never been at. It's almost as if time has stopped.
Right, absolutely. Absolutely. And I do. I have some friends that are calling going, what is going on? What's happening? And I do understand this all happened to all of us. So I'm pretty sure the system is very overwhelmed right now. And they're just trying to figure it all out. And I just got my link saying you need to send in your documents. But I'm like you. I kept it simple. Something that I think I can. And I think honestly, as a business owner, that's one of the things that has sort of kept me afloat. I'm not audacious. I try to be very thoughtful about my expenses and what I want to invest in and what we need to focus on, mostly people. And I think that's the thing that's really keeping me afloat now in terms of being prepared to be able to come out of this on the other side. Is there any talk about now in training really having businesses think through and talk about emergency plans? I know as I talk to nonprofits, they all have an emergency plan because it's required by their funders. Most not for profits are just trying to figure out how to pay their bills by the end of the month. So is there going, I've been to some workshops where there's been an indicator that we should be doing this, but nothing formally, probably not mandated, but just a formal way of really looking at your emergency plan. Have there been taught? Are we rethinking that in the training spectrum when it comes to? Well,
and I think that we need to, because right now everyone is in an emergency. But I think that those are things that as business owners, we've actually had to have, you know, an exit strategy when it comes to the business.
Mm-hmm.
I know a lot of people are trying to figure out, am I going to sell the business? Am I going to, you know what, grow? And those are answers that businesses need to ask for themselves. How much do you want to scale? Do you want 5 employees? Do you want 10? Do you want 15? And I think that that starts right now with the strategy. Mm-hmm. It's coming in and running the business effectively. One of the things that I keep hearing with a lot of business owners is like, oh, well, all my employees are 1099. They're consultants, where technically they're not your employees, because mm-hmm. an employee gets paid by way of W-2 because you're paying taxes on those employees.
Mm-hmm.
A 1099 is a consultant that comes in and provides a service for you. And once that service is over and done with, you they're pay
gone.
Them. Leave. So as business owners, if a lot of them would have come in and done the W-2 and paid taxes and done, they could have qualified for a lot of things that are going on right now. But those are the plans that you need to start doing from when you started back then. One of the things that I get from a lot of business is, hey, when I started this, I didn't really know what I was doing, but I need help. So I do believe that now, in the wake of what we're experiencing, you need to have a contingency plan when, you know what, disaster hits. I mean, we're used to hurricanes. So
correct.
What are you doing? What are you doing when you don't have internet? Right now we've got internet. It's slow, right. But we got internet. It's dropping, but we've got internet, you
right.
know, and we have the flexibility to still order food and help the small business community, have it delivered, have everything. But I think that that's one of the things, going back to, you know, what we were originally talking about. A lot of businesses are not going to survive because they did not plan for the future.
Right.
They did not welcome technology into their place of business.
Right.
A lot of people are fearful. Listen, I did a webinar on how to use, you know what, Zoom. And something that simple as business owners, because we have this mindset that this is how things have to be in order to be successful.
Right, absolutely.
And I've seen businesses that do not have all of the criteria of what you would think success is, but they're successful. So
right.
You know what? I come in and I'm like, just do what you need to do. Do the right thing, but be mindful that you have to have dialogue and conversations with other business owners to find out what it is that they're doing and have a relationship. Listen, not everything and not every person that you come in contact with has a dollar sign on their forehead. And it's not a sale that you're coming in. I think that what we need to do is build and talk to other people and find out what is it that they've done.
Uh-huh.
What are they currently doing? What are they currently doing? And how can we help one another?
Well, we know, and we just talked about this a little bit, there are some businesses that will not make it through this. They won't survive. I actually received an email that talked about, you know, if you want to join this webinar on when is it the right time to pull the plug. What are some of the things you're maybe advising or thinking about in terms of speaking to small businesses who may be at that point? What's the recommendation? How do you know it's time to pull the plug, et cetera, et cetera?
Yeah, and you know what? And I think that one of the things with a lot of businesses, it's what your gut tells you. Because I know that there were times, because there's a difference. I know that I had moments when I wanted to throw in the towel.
Right, absolutely.
I wanted to give up because I pulled everybody. So I'm like, yeah, I'm done.
I did, but this morning.
I know. I'm like, you know what, Lord, you know that I'm done. I'm not going to do this. I'm like, but I think that there's that moment that you throw in the towel, but then you come in. And I'm like, yeah, I'm not ready to come in and throw in the towel as of yet. Now it's, you need to come in and make the assessment of where is my business at?
Mm-hmm.
You know, what is going my business going to look like after this? Do I have the capacity to pivot? Do I have the capacity to change? What am I going to start doing now when it comes to marketing the business? And do I have the arsenal in my bag of tricks to do that? Because if you keep going and going and going, because sometimes, listen, as entrepreneurs, we are different. And sometimes we're hard-headed. But I sit back and tell people, listen, I can't work for anybody else. I'm not a 9-to-5er. Okay. I can't sit down at a desk and do. So I know that about myself. So I do believe that my goal in doing a lot of the things that I do now is to save as many businesses as we can with information. Okay. But the reality is that a lot of businesses may fail because a lot of business owners were not willing to listen. They were not willing to change. Mm-hmm. They were not willing to morph and to invest in doing the right things, technology and so forth. So okay. I think that right now, before this is over and done with, I would encourage every business owner to make an assessment of where their business is financially, where their business is in the sales process, in the actual in the marketing process, because remember, there's a lot of businesses out there that are restaurants. Some businesses,
absolutely.
You know, plenty of restaurants, and restaurants right now, you know what, they may be affected, but people are still ordering food. People still have curbside going and picking up and so forth. But a lot of them have become the small mom and pop restaurants have become, you know what, ingenious. And they've actually started doing, I know that a friend of mine, you know what, in Miami Springs, Siamo, pizza, they actually started going in and, you know, giving certain things and selling stuff half price, you know, especially
okay.
when people are drinking, you know, but right now, my thing is that be creative. That's where the creativity comes in. And these are things that I'm just seeing where people are posting online. And I believe that if you have that creativity, then do it. And if you're not doing anything and just sitting idle, listen, a lot of people are getting depressed because of this. A lot of people, their mindset has been discouraged because, listen, my parents, they've been married for 60 years. And my mother, she was used to going out and doing groceries with my siblings, with my sisters. You know what? My dad, you know, used to playing dominoes and doing stuff. Mm-hmm. So right now it's like, you know what? I go there to drop something off and they're standing there like looking at us through the window and trying to figure out. And I'm like, you know what? So I called them and I said, listen, we're going to plan your vacation, you know, and see where. So I said, so mom, you're actually going to spend your vacation in the bathroom and pop, yours is going to be spent in, you know, at the living room. So they started laughing. But I think that right now, when you start processing this, you know, I make light of it, but it's difficult for them. So imagine for those of us that actually employ people that we help. I think that that's the biggest takeaway for me in this, Stephanie, mm-hmm. the amount of business owners that love and appreciate their employees.
I agree.
And they feel so bad. They feel like their hands are tied.
I agree.
Can't help them.
I think they found a family in their team, you know what yeah. I mean? And many of the business owners that I've spoken to have found that, you know, their employees will step up and make things happen on, you know, for the business because they're just as invested. This is my job and I've got to do this to the best of my ability. And I think that's been a wonderful thing to learn from other business owners and from my own staff who've been wonderful as well. Are you afraid or optimistic about the future of your business right now?
Listen,
and this is the first time I've asked this question.
I know. Listen, I'm not afraid of nothing.
I know.
Nothing. Listen,
with the right person.
I am very optimistic, but listen, just to give you a little background, I grew up in a home where my mom took us to church and taught us about Jesus. Okay. Mm-hmm. And you know what? We didn't grow up Catholic. We grew up in an interdenominational church mm-hmm. Or non-denominational. But then when I would come home, my dad would teach us how to cuss, gamble, play cards, and smoke cigars. So I tell people, listen, you know what? I will cuss you out in the name of Jesus and keep walking. So, but my thing is that I live on hope. I live, you know what, on a brighter future. I look for the good in people because we all have good in us. But I do believe I'm not scared of this. Listen, I'm not scared of this because I'm not fearful. I don't live in fear. You know what it is? I looked fear in the face. I said hello and I kept walking. And I think that that's the main thing that we need to be mindful of. Listen, a lot of people have held on to their faith. A lot of people have actually found faith. A lot of people are in panic because, oh, the apocalypse is coming and yeah, yeah, yeah. But my thing is that I haven't shifted or changed anything that I'm doing. I just started creating new things mm-hmm. on Sunday night with my family. It's Easter. We normally go to my parents' house. So what do we end up doing? We ended up having game night. So we took a Zoom call and we created a game. We did an online, I think it was Jackbox.tv, but we played and laughed for you know a couple of hours.
Good.
So yeah, so I think that right now, this is also an opportunity for people to take an in-depth look inside who they are and what they can do and what they can accomplish. Because listen, if this never would have happened, you would not be interviewing me right now. Because this is not something that you would be thinking about. How do I shift and how do I pivot and how do I change?
I agree.
And I believe that that's what people want. People want someone to come in and tell them, hey, it's okay.
It's going to be okay. I agree. And that's, that's really one of the reasons why I wanted to start this, because I was having some of those conversations personally. And as you and I have talked about, you know, many small business owners work in a silo. We're trying to figure it out daily and our heads are down and we can only lean on support systems that are immediately around us. And I was like, you know, I'm hearing such good things. I want other people, other business owners to hear good things, hopefully, and in these conversations, get a morsel of not only hope, but guidance as to how to just put your foot forward, hold your head down, and make it through.
Yeah, I agree.
I have to tell you, I typically, most of my conversations have been around 30 minutes, but this has been so good. It extended to 45, so I'm excited.
I told you that I'm shy and I don't like to talk.
I knew this was going to be a good one. So I want to say thank you very much for this information. I think it's been a wealth of information. I was excited about you being on, not only so you could talk about your business, but I knew you had sort of background knowledge with that training background of what businesses, where businesses should be right now, and could deliver that glimmer of hope, whatever happens on the other end of the pandemic. We're going to look to you to keep sort of being our advocate and champion when it comes to talking to local business on our behalf and helping them understand what our needs are, and hopefully many of them heard you say we want to do a task force that really looks realistically at the needs of small businesses in Miami-Dade County and throughout the country. But before we leave, I'd like to ask you, how can people get in touch with you?
Listen, I am all over the place. My handle on Twitter is Orlando in Miami. I write a blog for myself. And I just write stuff because I need to stay motivated. I self-motivate myself, which there's a difference between self-motivated and self-medicating.
I self-motivate. That's another conversation.
Exactly. But I self-motivate. And I believe that looking at what my parents accomplished, coming from a communist country, and being able to see that they never put any limitations on anything that we did, my siblings, we've all been business owners. And one thing that I've always told people, I don't put limitations on anybody because I don't want anybody putting limitations on me. And I sit back and I realize that, listen, Orlando Espinosa, you can find me on Twitter, Facebook, I'm all over. You can actually find me. One of the things that I do is that I kept it real and genuine, but I've also set back. And another thing that I will tell people to keep their sanity, stop watching the news, watching the media, because I'm looking at right now and researching that, listen, we have a 98%, rate of people that have recovered from the COVID.
But we're not talking about the recovery.
We're not talking about that. We're talking about
the devastation.
The devastation, the death and gloom. And I feel bad for the people that have actually lost loved ones.
But you and I understand that because that's marketing. That's wording. That's how we, now don't get me wrong. I'm not saying don't, dismiss what needs to be done with COVID-19, but you've got to really look at the opposite side as well to keep sort of a balanced perspective for yourself, because the recoveries are never, we send out an email weekly. And in one of the emails, I wanted to make a point of, these are the recoveries. People are recovering from this. So please don't feel like this is a death sentence. We can make it through it. We just have to take the necessary steps of which to do that. So I'm glad you definitely brought that up.
Yeah. And I think that that's what it is, because I don't live with doom and gloom. I don't sit back and my life is not dictated by what I see and hear. It's more so by way of my gut. So I encourage people to, research and talk to other people, because right now I've got a very extensive group of friends, and people that I know nationally. Mm-hmm. And one of the conversations that we've been having is, do you know anyone that has, COVID-19? Do you know? And we had to come in and have dialogue and say, I don't know anybody. I don't know. And then as things shifted and changed, well, I know someone that actually posted on Facebook that they did have. And for me, it's like, yes, it's devastating. And I get that. But when you come in and all you hear is death, death.
I agree.
What point are you going to come in and look at life? And I think that right now that affects our psyche. And I don't follow, what everybody else says. I stick to my guns and follow my gut instinct. And I think that that's one of the things, as business owners, we need to come in and take this time, Stephanie, I think, to have more dialogue, have more conversations, and use this as a platform to say, okay, now we endured this. Now we survived this. What next? What can we not survive? Right. Listen, we're in Florida. Hurricane. We're always told there's a hurricane.
At this point, I feel like you can survive anything if you survive.
Exactly. So it's like, we got a hurricane coming. It's a category 98, 95.
That's, you know? Okay. We made it through this.
Listen, we're 305. You know what? We survived. You know what? 305, and now we have to say 786. And 954 and all that stuff. But one thing that I will tell you, Stephanie, is that these are the moments that we have to come in and live by the code, mm-hmm. that we have to move on no matter what life throws our way.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
That's my code. That's how I live. And thank you so much for having me on.
Thank you,
Richard. I know that we talked 2-3 hours. I know we did.
And we hope to talk to you later today.
Yeah. Listen, my conversation is like, normally it's like, hey, listen, just 5 minutes. And I'm like, okay.
Nope.
You know? And I think that that's one of the things right now that people just need to have other people to talk to right now.
I agree.
Pick up the phone, talk to family and friends that you haven't spoken to in a while.
Absolutely.
If someone comes to mind. And call each other as business owners, even if they're the participant, and check on them to see how they are doing.
I agree. And with that, I thank you so much. Thank you for sharing this with everyone. We'll be here again tomorrow. But thanks again, Orlando. I will talk to you tonight.
All right. Thank you. Appreciate it. Have a good evening.
Appreciate you.
Actually.
Wait, I just put you back on. Wait, let's see. Okay, he said, good afternoon. You want to say it again?
Good afternoon, not good evening.
Thank you so much for joining us today. As I mentioned, this has been a much longer show because we just have a lot to talk about, and I know he would be a wealth of information for small business owners. We hope you will tune in tomorrow, where we will be talking to Evan St. Fort, who is the owner of St. Fort Funeral Home and Cremations. They are dealing with a different dynamic right now in this pandemic space when it comes to small business development, and I thought it would be very important to talk to them a little bit about how they're maneuvering the landmines and pivoting, that's the word, during this time. So we'll see you tomorrow at 10 o'clock with Evan St. Fort. And thank you so much for tuning in. You have a great day.